conservative movement. Ms. Pavlich is the news editor for townhall.com and a contributing editor to Townhall magazine. She is the author of the New York Times bestseller, Fast and Furious, Barack Obama's Bloodiest Scandal and Its Shameless Cover-Up. Her latest book, Assault and Flattery, The Truth About the Left and Their War on Women, was released during the summer of 2014. As a reporter, Ms. Pavlich has covered topics ranging from the White House scandals and the 2012 presidential election to the Second Amendment and border issues. She is a graduate of the University of Arizona with a degree in journalism and is a current National Review Washington Fellow. She has shared her perspective on multiple media venues, including Fox News, CNN, MSNBC, CNBC, and Fox News, in addition to a host of national and local radio shows. In 2014, she was awarded the Woman of the Year from the Claire Booth Luce Policy Institute and has continued to be a prominent leader, inspiring young girls to have a voice within the conservative movement. Her deep love of the outdoors and respect for firearms are rooted in the formative experiences of growing up in the mountains of northern Arizona, rafting the Colorado River through the Grand Canyon, and hunting big game with her father in the forests and deserts that Barry Goldwater called home. Ms. Pavlich was recently married in Israel and currently resides in the Washington, D.C. area. Please help me welcome Ms. Katie Pavlich.
Do I hear some Arizona Wildcats back there? Woohoo! Bear down! That's awesome. Well, I made it through the rain and the torrential downpours, which if you're not from here and you're experiencing it for the first time, it really is quite amazing. But it's great to be back here with YAF and with all the YAFers, and thank you to Ron Robinson for having me here, and to Young America's Foundation, of course, for fighting for conservative principles on college campuses. I see Grant is here. I saw him 5 years ago at a high school conference, and Spencer, I've known him for a couple of years now, Spencer Brown, doing a ton of amazing work for the movement and for Young America's Foundation. So great to see some old friends, and it's awesome to see so many new faces as well. And most importantly, I think that we should be thanking you, and I hope that other speakers have done this as well, for being engaged on your college campuses and for standing up for principles that genuinely make people's lives better and more free. And I know it's not easy, and I know that there are lots of safe spaces on your campuses, but I know that you're not welcome in any of them. So you are definitely stronger for it. One of YAF's biggest themes as of late is freedom over socialism. And I don't think that this theme could have come at a better time. Young people seem to be enamored these days, not you guys, but I'm sure you know a lot of your peers, enamored with socialism. And this is a system that limits their personal choices, their individuality, their ability to make decisions for themselves and eventually for their families, and one that overall makes people less free and beholden to the government. And we see socialism play out in certain ways. We've heard socialism and seen socialism creeping into certain programs here in the United States. We, of course, see socialism in Europe. But we're seeing the most extreme forms of socialism that is embraced by the left play out in Venezuela right now. And I'm going to talk about that because I think it's really important to take a look at the seriousness of the situation to understand what the end result of socialism really is. So why do we care about Venezuela? Well, it's important to pay attention for a number of reasons. One of them being, as Americans, and as Ronald Reagan showed us, we care about human rights and human freedom around the world. And we also need to pay attention to Venezuela because many members on the prominent left have been upholding Venezuela as a socialist utopia for years. And now as the country falls into violence and crisis, there is silence from them. And finally, history is being made, and we need to remember this moment and pay attention because it's going to affect us in America, our policies moving forward, for decades to come, depending on what happens there. So to give you a little bit of history, Venezuela's main export is oil. They used to be the fourth richest country in the world. And yet today, the country is on the brink of civil war, as the government has failed to provide what it promised to distribute in plenty for the people. According to the Cato Institute, President Maduro, his new, they're calling them new Marxist policies, of abolishing property rights, inheritance, centralization of credit to the state, and the confiscation of property from immigrants has landed Venezuela as number 181 of 189 on the World Bank's 2014 Doing Business ranking. They've fallen even further at that point in the year 2017, which puts Venezuela behind Syria, Afghanistan, and Iraq when it comes to doing business. Starving Venezuelans have been rushing the Colombian border for food and have been hunting in the streets for cats and dogs. They've been smuggling milk on their bodies like drug dealers would smuggle narcotics, and they've been breaking into zoos to kill animals for meat. Now, the government is currently rationing electricity and toilet paper in the name of fairness, but in a free market system, capitalist free market America, the vast majority of Americans don't have a shortage of any of these things, and we could never dream of having to do any of these things. And not surprisingly, President Maduro has been blocking humanitarian aid from coming into the country for months and has been blaming all of his country's problems on the United States, despite our efforts to try and help the people there. Over the past 5 years, police have been ordered to go door to door, confiscating and crushing firearms in the name of crime reduction, which is really just a cover up for the government to make people defenseless while also planning to set up an ammunition registry. Their argument is that they were going to bring disarmament for peace, when the real truth is that they wanted disarmament for control. Venezuela is now one of the most crime-ridden countries in the entire world, and 90% of murders go unsolved. So where is the left that's been upholding places like Venezuela and Cuba as these wonderful places that everyone should emulate, especially the United States, for years? As my colleague Greg Gutfeld said last night on The Five, for years, leftist Hollywood has praised Venezuela as a beautiful example of how socialism works for people. After all, it was actor Sean Penn who regularly visited former President Hugo Chavez, and of course, Hugo Chavez handpicked President Maduro as his successor. In 2006, President Obama's mentor, Bill Ayers, traveled to Venezuela to help Chavez celebrate the socialism of the 21st century. Michael Moore praised the government's takeover of Venezuela's oil industry in the name of eliminating poverty as something that lots of different governments should do to help the people. Director Oliver Stone said that Chavez was a comrade, and that he loved him, that he would miss him once he was gone. But these same people, these elitists who have all the money in the world, who could be helping the humanitarian situation, have been missing in the face of extreme human rights abuses and chaos the left claims to stand against. And the question is why. And they're not speaking up as this collapse happens, because condemning this type of socialism in Venezuela would be a condemnation and indictment of Marxism and far-left ideology as a whole. And of course, the leftist media is also complacent. You haven't heard a whole lot about what's going on in the last 2 weeks with Venezuela, with the elections, with Maduro taking over control, and it's because they don't want to talk about the fact that socialism is at the center of the chaos, and socialism, of course, is part of their liberal narrative. In 2014, this is what I tweeted. I said, "The left has been upholding Venezuela for decades, and we wonder why the liberal media isn't covering what's happening now." And it's because things haven't changed. We have to make it absolutely clear that Venezuela is not an exception to the rule of socialism, but inevitably the end result of government promising to take over industries bureaucrats claim they can run better than the private sector. When they're willing to speak up about this issue, the left will argue that this isn't real socialism, That's a different kind of real socialism. This isn't socialism being implemented in the right way. But no, this is it. This is what it is. This is the ultimate end result of exactly the policies that they push, not just here in America, but for the rest of the world. I know that you guys participate in No More Che Day, right, to condemn Che Guevara and the Castro regime on your campuses, in Cuba, of course, which the left has been worshiping Che Guevara and the Castro regime. How many of your professors, you know, glorify Che Guevara on a regular basis? I had a professor in college. I was in a Latin American pop culture class, which is so stupid. I had to take that class. Like, what does that have to do with anything I'm doing now? Probably cost me $5,000 to take that class. And she was talking all about the joys of Che Guevara and how he was such a revolutionary and he was so amazing. And so, you know, the T-shirts, of course, that everyone wears with his face, and they don't really know who he is, but they act like he's a hero. I wore a shirt with his face that had him marked out and sat right on the aisle where the professor would walk back and forth, so she should make sure that I at least knew who Che Guevara was and wasn't going to accept that he was a hero. But going back to No Che Day and the left worshiping Cuba and the healthcare system there and the fact that they have free education, what we're seeing right now in Venezuela is very similar to what we saw in Cuba. And keep in mind, Cuba is something the left has been pushing as an amazing socialist utopia that we should embrace. We saw the Obama administration do this. And what we're seeing in Venezuela now is very similar to what we saw during the Castro regime. People being kidnapped from their homes in the middle of the night, thrown in prison, or executed for simply dissenting from the government or trying to participate in a fair and free democracy. The left loves Cuba, and Hollywood is constantly telling people they should be visiting the communist country for a retro experience. Kim Kardashian went to Cuba last year, and she tweeted and Instagrammed about how the cars there are so cool because they're like from 1950. It's like, yeah, they're from 1950 because it's a communist country that doesn't allow any kind of industry to come in, and you're glorifying poverty and tyranny by acting like this is some kind of museum. I don't think that her government tour included people starving in the streets or the healthcare facilities where infant mortality is up, and yet this is the kind of thing in Cuba that liberal Hollywood promotes, but it's actually happening in Venezuela, and they're silent. So in Venezuela, where the evils of socialism are very real, this week the White House announced new sanctions, not just for officials in Venezuela, but on President Maduro himself, which puts him in the same category as North Korean President Kim Jong-un and Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. Now think about that for a second. Unfortunately, I think in 20 years, we're probably going to see on college campuses leftists wearing T-shirts with Maduro's face on it, thinking that he's some kind of hero because he has been glorified and praised so much by the left. And this is where I think it's important to bring in Bernie Sanders and to talk about what a fraud he is. He has not only praised this kind of system, specifically in Venezuela, calling it this amazing, beautiful place that the United States could only dream of being, but he's leading a dangerous and ignorant movement, and he ran for president and almost beat Hillary Clinton. This is who he is. He's a guy who has spent his entire life not producing, but taking from other people. He's lived in the greatest country on earth, the United States, and yet has spent a lifetime trying to destroy the very free market system that has brought him so much prosperity, including 3 homes. He has all this amazing stuff that he's not willing to share with anybody. He has a lake house in Vermont. I'd like to go hang out in the lake house in Vermont. Is he willing to spread the wealth around a little bit? I don't think so. But before turning 40 years old, Bernie Sanders lived in a rundown shack with a dirt floor. And it wasn't because the system was against him, it's because he spent all of his time playing the victim. When he failed to do any private sector job well, including writing salacious stories and working as a carpenter, He blamed free market straw men for all of his problems. He made excuses rather than learning from mistakes and bettering himself, not to mention taking responsibility for his own decisions and failures. When the opportunity to enter politics came along, he jumped at the chance and has been funded by the American taxpayer ever since. In the 1980s, a young Bernie Sanders further proved his socialist zealotry by praising breadlines in Nicaragua as a sign of economic progress, fairness, and success. This is what he said. He said, "You know, it's funny, sometimes American journalists talk about how bad a country is when people are lining up for food. That's a good thing. In other countries, people don't line up for food. The rich get the food and the poor starve to death." And when he's talking about other countries, he's talking about the United States of America, which is the most generous country in the world that feeds its poor and the poor of the rest of the world as well. On the 2016 campaign trail, Bernie Sanders developed a following of millennials with speeches about a free utopia and justice for the evil rich who are keeping poor people down. But reality proves that Sanders' promises can never be kept and teaches us that there is no such thing as free, period. There's no free college, no free housing, no free healthcare, no free cell phone service, and confiscation of 100% of America's wealthiest individual assets, the top 1%, the rich that Bernie Sanders and his followers like to vilify, wouldn't put a dent in the national debt, not to mention provide free everything to the other 99%. The only thing that can provide for you is you, yourself, and your individual dignity to get out and work and reach your dreams in an American society where you can be anything you want to be so long as you are willing to do the work that will get you there. Socialism is a system that is sold as fair. Everyone is treated equally despite how much money an individual may have in his bank account. But the harsh reality is that socialism not only destroys economic freedom, it severely limits the capability of everyone to reach their maximum potential. It's a system that doesn't provide more, but provides vastly less. Sanders isn't offering an easier, more sustainable lifestyle. He's offering dependence, hardship, and despair. The definition of free under his policies means taking from someone else, just as Bernie Sanders has done for his entire life. But despite Bernie Sanders' dishonest offerings, there still is hope. Now, I know that a lot of your peers on campus probably think that they like socialism, they think it's a good concept. But according to the Cato Institute research fellow, Emily Akins, and she wrote this in the Washington Post, she said, "The expanded social welfare state Sanders thinks the United States should adopt requires everyday people to pay considerably more in taxes. Yet millennials become averse to social welfare spending if they foot the bill. So if they're the ones, which inevitably they would be, paying for things, they then don't want to be paying for everyone else's things. They want to pay for their own things. As they reach the threshold of earning $40,000 to $60,000 a year, a majority of millennials come to oppose income redistribution, including raising taxes to increase financial assistance to the poor. Similarly, a Reason poll found that while millennials still on their parents' health insurance policies supported the idea of paying higher premiums to cover the uninsured, support flipped with millennials when they were paying for their own health insurance, and they opposed higher premiums to pay for everyone else. Now, a recent YouGov survey showed and asked voters of all ages whether they had a favorable view or unfavorable view of socialism versus capitalism. And respondents younger than 30 were the only group that rated socialism more favorable than capitalism. But this is an important point. When young people are asked if they want more government intervention in their lives, they answer, "No, we don't want the government telling us what to do. We don't want them intervening in our decisions. We don't want them telling us what we can and cannot do with our lives and our decisions." And when they're asked to define what socialism is, they can't do it. In fact, I think a lot of people think it's social media, which is really sad. They really don't understand what it means. And so when progressive leftist politicians and professors sell young people false hope about free stuff, including noble pursuits like a college education. They're being extremely disingenuous and setting young people up for a lifetime of debt to the government. So how do you change this? This is the big question, right? How can we work to change people's minds if that many people have a favorable view of socialism, something that they don't really understand? How do you educate your peers about how socialism is actually an evil system that keeps people in poverty all around the world and has been doing so for decades, if not hundreds of years? You have to talk to them. I know that you guys are active on campus. You're having conversations. Bring new people to your meetings who you disagree with, maybe people who are Bernie Sanders supporters, and have a discussion about the differences in these economic systems. Ask them questions about what they think socialism really is, because odds are they don't know. You can't blame people for not knowing something they've never been told. If they've been told something their whole life and never heard the other side of the story, well, then you can't blame them for not knowing. That's your job to let them know. Explain them how the free market allows them as an individual to be whoever they want to be and to make the choices for themselves rather than having someone else making them for them. I'm sorry, if you tell anyone under the age of 25, or any individual in general, mostly, unless you're Bernie Sanders, do you want someone telling you what to do? Do you really want to be living in your parents' house until you're 30? Do you really not want to be able to afford and pay your own bills, to earn your own paycheck, to make your decisions about what you want to buy, what you don't want to buy, how you want to spend your time, how you want to spend your money? And the answer, of course, is no, because young people don't want that. You reach the age of 18, you can't wait to get out of your parents' house, no matter how great your parents are. You want freedom, and that's what you have to remind people socialism is actually against. On campus, you're clearly already involved because you're here. You've been learning all week long about conservative ideas that make people's lives better and more free. And it is your job to take back what you learned this week to your college campuses and to teach it to people who may not know. So on that note, I'll take your questions, and thank you so much for being here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, thank you for coming out tonight. My question is, I know that if we bring up, you know, Venezuela and Cuba, they're going to counter with points like the Nordic states where they have socialized medicine and free college, and they are still economically prosperous. So how would you recommend we respond to counterpoints like that?
You can argue that they're, quote, economically prosperous, but they are limited in their individual freedom. So if you want to pay 75% in taxes, that's something that limits your freedom and ability to grow. Also, Norway is a very different country than the United States in terms of the economy and what's provided. And in the long term, eventually those types of systems fail because you can't have a small minority of people at the top continually paying for the rest of the country. So it might not happen now, might not happen in the next 30 years, but eventually those types of systems collapse because, as Margaret Thatcher said, socialism is something that can't sustain itself because you eventually run out of other people's money.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Over here?
Hi, I'm Mason Sanders, and I go to Henderson State University. And something I've noticed arguing with socialists, like my best friend's a socialist, so we do it all the time.
That's good, though. Yeah, not that he's a socialist, but that you argue.
The thing that I've noticed is once you start proving them wrong, like on Obamacare and how bad it's failed and everything like that, they become more steadfast in what they believe in, and they just start forcing it down your throat and saying that you're just an evil person who doesn't care about the poor because I'm so anti-welfare and he's the opposite, you know, and I don't know how to debate whenever he gets into that because I can't pull him back into policies. He just keeps going to morality, and I don't know how to stay away from it.
That is a very difficult thing that the left knows how to do well. If they can't win an argument based on facts and logic, they immediately call you a racist or an immoral person. I think that ending the conversation at that point is a good idea and just say, look, we both have goals of helping poor people. We just have different ways of getting there. And this is what I think. I think that people should have more individual freedom. And this is the path to get there. And I think that people getting off welfare is actually more beneficial to them than having to be stuck in a system where someone else is taking care of them for the rest of their lives and ending it there. But it's good that you're having those kinds of debates. And I don't know if he's necessarily being so steadfast. I think he probably goes home and goes, you know, maybe I should think about that for a second. He probably just gets very defensive. So having those conversations at least makes people think, and he might not change his mind, but at least he'll think about it.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, my name's Greg. I'm from Pennsylvania. And my my question for you is, why do you think socialism refuses to die?
Because I think it's human nature in terms of people in government who have power to want to control mass populations of people. And that's why the American story is so unique, because America is based on an idea of individual freedom and liberty and dignity, which the rest of the world has tried to emulate in some ways because it doesn't exist anywhere else. And so I think it's human nature for governments to try and control people, which is why socialism still exists.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes?
Hello, my name is Benjamin Schrader from Texas A&M University.
Awesome.
I wanted to ask you, what would you say is your number one argument against socialism?
That it takes away your freedom, and I want to be free.
Hello, my name's Ryan. I'm from the United Kingdom.
Oh,
and
nice.
We've got a socialist leader of the opposition who basically thinks, like Bernie Sanders, that it's some sort of Venezuela, some sort of utopia. And
you should go live there then. I'm sure it's much nicer than London.
And a group of his supporters were gathered, and they all had like iPhones and Starbucks and stuff like that.
Right.
So, people, do you think one of the problems is that people take these things for granted? And also, what do you think of the dangers of Bernie or someone like him winning in America in the future? Because he, in the recent election in the UK, the far left leader like Corbyn actually got 40% of the vote.
Well, we've seen socialist candidates. I mean, being a socialist in America, or a communist, quite frankly, used to be frowned upon, something we didn't really tolerate. But we've seen at the local level in places like Seattle, openly socialist candidates have won on those local levels. So to assume that it couldn't happen nationally would be very ignorant. And underestimating the ability of that to happen would be detrimental. I think that it could happen, but that's why we're all here, to stop it from happening and to educate people about how that doesn't actually bring us to a place where more people can prosper. What was your first question?
Do people take things like
absolutely.
iPhones for granted?
Yeah, this is something that I think is so ironic, especially with the climate change movement and the socialist movement, is they love organizing all of their protests on their iPhone, on Facebook, and all these amazing things that come from free market societies where people can be innovative, where yes, there is some kind of government regulation, but not in the form of socialist countries. And they certainly take for granted and don't really understand how it is to live in a place where you don't have access to these things. And I actually call it first world problems, as many of you probably say that as well. But I think a lot of people who live in America actually don't have, quote, real problems, so they can take advantage of the fact or for granted that they have access to all these amazing things and don't really know where they come from. It's like the climate change activists who are typing away on their computer and it's plugged into the wall. It's like everything in your computer came from a mine, came from the ground, and everything going into your computer is coming from a coal mine in West Virginia or Pennsylvania. So I don't think they really understand where things come from. So asking them those questions about, well, you have an iPhone, don't you? Don't you understand where that comes from? Is a way to kind of get people to realize that it's not for free. So.
Thank you.
Yep. Safe travels.
Hi, yes. My name is Jose Avendano, and I, coming from Latin America and Central America, in which...
Which country?
El Salvador.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm from El Salvador. So.
You're not at MS-13, right?
No. That's another point
I'm just
like
kidding.
To say.
You don't have any tattoos, but, so you
I was actually blessed enough to be privileged in that country and to actually have education. Mm-hmm. But one of the main arguments in which I come from a socialist country, and I've seen socialism as its main work, and I come here and I try to discuss how actually it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
And I put as an example, as you said, Venezuela. And they clearly said, but we're not Venezuela. Our economy is not like Venezuela. Mm-hmm. Our demographic, it's not like Venezuela. And our geography is not like Venezuela. How could we actually fight with them to let them know that at the end it's the same?
I think you look at it and say the principles of socialism are the same. The government taking more from people and deciding where they're going to distribute it. The government being in control of industries that should be private. The government promising to provide things to people that they eventually cannot promise. The principles of socialism are the same, whether it's in Venezuela or other countries. But I think that you actually could tell us all about really what the similarities are better than I can. But the principles are the same, and the end result is the same, and that is the government making decisions for individuals because they believe that they are better at making decisions than the people who live there. And that's a real problem.
Right. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Hi, Katie. My name is...
Good to see you again.
Good to see you again. I've told you before about the horror story of my father who spent his early years under Chairman Mao Zedong's socialist government in China, and that how he nearly starved to death during his rule. Yet there are students that I've come across that because China is gradually becoming economically more prosperous, they say that they think that China is a model of success of socialism. How do we counter that argument?
Well, you can tell them, first of all, that they don't have Twitter in China to start. No, I mean, I had a teaching assistant in college who made this point. He was asking us about the one-child policy, and we were talking about it, and he asked the class if this kind of policy would work in any other country. And I responded by saying, well, it can only work in a communist system because you can't enforce it otherwise. And he argued with me in front of the entire class that China is not a communist country, that it's a capitalist country. After we're talking about the one-child policy, which is enforced by the government against families. And so, first of all, I think that this attitude that they know better than you when you have experience is their first problem. But the second issue is, again, the principles are the same. Sure, they are economically prosperous in a very controlled way, but there are lots of sectors in the Chinese economy that aren't successful. And if you look at the living aspect of the people there, look at how people live. How are people living in Venezuela? How are people living in China? Sure, the economy might be doing well, but how are the people living? Are they prospering? And the answer is really no when you look at across the board if people can be individuals and be prosperous. In China, they decide if you're going to be prosperous or not based on what they want you to do. So again, it comes down to individual freedom and liberty and how much freedom you have as an individual living in a country to make your own decisions.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, Katie. Thank you so much for coming. My name's Heidi Tom. I'm from Whitworth University. So my question's, it's a little bit of a two-part, but pretty simple. Just as we are the situation right now, how can America still help Venezuela? Like with the restrictions and everything, what are our next steps to helping? And also, if today you were put at the head of this Venezuelan government, how would you begin the process of helping their country where it is right now?
If I was in charge, first I would not engage in massive voter fraud to put myself in power. I would listen to the will of the people, first of all. So that's what I would do if I was in charge. The second thing is I would deregulate the oil industry and put it back into the private sector, because one of the reasons why Venezuela fell into the chaos it is now is when the government started nationalizing all of these different sectors, the oil industry being the one that made them the fourth richest country in the world. So I would put that back to the private sector. In terms of what the United States can do, as I mentioned, they've put these sanctions on President Maduro, and he doesn't really care that they put these sanctions on him. We haven't gone to the point yet where we're not going to import Venezuelan oil, which is something that we could do, but that will also have some kind of ramification here economically, so I know that they've hesitated a little bit, but that's really all I know about what we could do at this point. I know that the president has offered to send in humanitarian aid. That has been completely rejected by the government there. So we've tried to do what we can. But the implications for the United States are huge here. I mean, it sounds like, okay, Venezuela's a country in South America. Why do we care? It's a border issue if we start seeing refugees coming up through South America and going over the southern border. It's an issue of energy in terms of oil prices. And it's also an issue of national security, because one thing that a lot of people don't talk about, and this has been going on for years, is that the Iranians actually have Hezbollah cells in Venezuela, and they train there, and they're allies with the Venezuelan government there. They were under Chavez, and they are under Maduro. So this actually does have very serious implications for the United States on a lot of different levels, which is why we have to be paying attention to it.
Thank you.
Hello, Mrs. Pavlich. I'd like to thank you for making that speech about socialism. It's a very important issue to me. My mother actually lived in the Soviet Union, and it was really, really rough for her.
We should get a panel of these kids' parents. Seriously, bring them to a YAF conference to talk about their experience.
Yeah, it was truly horrible. Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask you about the Second Amendment. You are a very well-respected and well-known advocate of the Second Amendment. I'd like to ask you, why do you think the Second Amendment is so critical to defending liberty?
Well, as people say, an armed society is a polite society. And I think when the country was founded, the founding fathers realized, you know, one of the things that kicked off the revolution actually was the British government stealing gunpowder from the Virginia governor down in Williamsburg. And they realized at that point that you can't fight back against tyranny, and you don't have to get violent, but it's just the idea that the people are in control rather than the government that really matters. And as someone who's in media, I wholeheartedly believe that you can't have the First Amendment unless you have the Second. And if you look everywhere around the world, wherever there's a tyrannical regime, oppression, throughout human history, the United States is really the only place that has ever allowed its citizenry to be voluntarily armed. And there's a reason why we're more free than any other citizenry in the history of the world. And so it has to be protected, and it's not because it needs to be used as a violent measure against the government, even though that's why it was put into such a solid founding document. But, you know, it's an integral part of American freedom and who we are as a country.
Thank you.
Hello, Ms. Pavlich. My name is Carolyn Lindy. I'm a rising freshman at Hillsdale College.
Oh, nice.
And I was wondering, I think it's understood within the conservative movement that the idea of American exceptionalism and the American experience is unique to 1776, but what about the horrors of socialism and communism? Did that start within the last few centuries, or is that just in man's blood?
No, I think that's... it may not have been defined as socialism or Marxism, because Karl Marx obviously came far after a lot of the early days of humanity. But if you look at a lot of the systems of slavery that we've seen all over the world, and the Romans even, and the way that they ran things, it's the same kind of principle of government being in control and deciding for the rest of the people how they're gonna live their lives. So I don't think it's new. I think it's something that can be kept at bay. It's not going to, you know, go away completely ever, which is why it's so important not to take for granted that it has to be a constant fight. But yeah, I think it's been something that's in human nature, which again is why the American experiment is such a special thing.
Thank you.
Yep. All right, I have room for two more.
So, hi, Katie.
Hi, good to see you again.
Good to see you too. I wanted to ask you, as an author and as a speaker, you know, someone who's aim is to convince people of the truth that you're telling them. How do you counter people who respond by saying that the truth you're telling them isn't the truth? They've bought into some sort of misinformation and are unwilling to hear what you say as the truth, whether it's about...
I think asking them why and have them explain their argument to you. And asking them to research things for themselves, give them some resources that aren't necessarily conservative resources that they can look at. And not that conservative resources aren't 100% factual and true, it just gives a little more credibility if they're not willing to believe what you're saying. There is a certain sector of society that, and they would feel this way about conservatives as well, who you're not gonna be able to convince to change their mind. But if you can at least give them some kind of resource or interesting information in a way that they find palatable, then they might be willing to at least read it and think about it. And I think that really does make a difference. When I go to college campuses around the country, my favorite thing is speaking to conservative students, but it's also afterward having a liberal student or a moderate student or an apolitical person who decided to come to the event, and afterwards they'll come up and say, hey, I came in here disagreeing with you, and I still disagree with you, but I at least see where you're coming from. Or you'll have people say, I never thought of it that way before, I never heard that perspective. And then that person will go back to their dorm room and tell their roommate or tell their parents what they learned or what they heard. And that can kind of create a chain reaction when people are having these types of conversations. So even just planting that seed, I think, is very helpful.
Thanks.
Yep. Last question.
Thank you for coming to speak to us. My name is Frank Arlinghouse. I go to Howard Community College in Maryland. When you consider that, I mean, aside from the president has praised the economic recovery, even though you look at several other indicators that are not the unemployment stat, such as the employment percentage mm-hmm. and the fact that most of our recovery has been in part-time jobs, and that the median wage of the nation has not increased significantly for the last 20 years.
Right.
And other times during American history, you see periods where the economy goes into stagnation, mm-hmm. Such as the Great Depression, when you know we almost failed to come out of that. And you see a very sort of shift into where the idea comes in, where, well, maybe we should go socialism because it's not working.
Right.
Do you think that, you know, should Trump's policies continue to actually spark life into the economy that we haven't had the chance to see in the last 8 to 10 years, that if it does start to spark life in the economy, that we will see a sort of shift away from this, well, shift towards communism?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot that, I mean, let's not mistake that President Obama, when people called him a socialist, it's because those were his policies. He certainly believed in socialist policies. That's exactly what Obamacare was. Now you hear because Republicans can't get their act together that they now are going to push for single payer. The president's been in office for 6 months. I think he's going to need a little more time to get the economy, which has been at horrible GDP for almost a decade, to get turned around, so he deserves some patience. But I do think that with deregulation, and I do think that repealing Obamacare is very important in terms of getting the country moving again, because it affects every single sector of society. You talked about part-time jobs. The reason why most people are working part-time now is because companies aren't hiring because of Obamacare that requires a certain threshold for when you provide health insurance. You have people like Bill de Blasio in New York City saying that you have to be able, you have to have a license to dog walk now or to feed someone's fish on the weekend. So rejecting that kind of regulation, I think, is very important, and allowing the free market to breathe and giving them confidence that they're not going to be smothered with even more rules, regulations, and some kind of solidarity around what they're going to be able to do. In terms of their prosperity, is going to be very helpful. So I'm hopeful it will change, but it's definitely going to take holding people accountable and not falling into this idea that because you didn't repeal healthcare because of one vote, that you now get to give up because it's a sixth of the economy, and it's not only hurting people on a very individual level with premiums, but it's also hurting an entire sector of job growth, tourism, etc. So you can turn around. Thank you, guys. Enjoy the rest of your week.
Katie Pavlich. Let's keep it going for Katie Pavlich. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I noticed that I forgot to mention one thing when I first came up on stage. I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Kyle Fairby, the program officer for Young Americans for Freedom Chapter Services. I train our YAF chapters and help equip them with the knowledge and skills necessary to advance the conservative movement at their schools. This school year has been especially challenging for conservative students. Excuse me. This time last year, 15% of all YAF-sponsored speaking events faced protests or of some form or another from leftist students and faculty members on campus. Today, that percentage has tripled to 46%. We live in a time where 1 in 5 students are afraid to voice their opinions if they think someone will disagree with them. From vandalizing posters to hecklers, from Antifa to the alt-right, conservative students across the country have to work so much harder this year than ever to promote their values. I want to take a moment to recognize some exceptional advocates, rather champions of conservatism. Every year, the Young Americans for Freedom Board of Governors gathers to identify key chapters in the conservative movement. These chapters distinguish themselves by exhibiting rare qualities like boldness, perseverance, and leadership. These chapters act with a purpose. They identify the issues on campus that matter to students, and they organize to overcome them. They're brave, they're passionate, and most importantly, they serve as beacons for other conservatives on campus to look up to. Now, before I reveal the chapter of the year, I would like to recognize our runners-up for the accomplishments. When I call your chapter, please stand and be recognized. Lynn Cemetilli of the University of Buffalo. Claire McKinney and University of Notre Dame YAF. Mark Honding and Derek Payton and all of CSULA YAF. Grant Wolf and Southern Methodist University YAF. And now for the chapter of the year. Please join me in congratulating Kara Bell and University of Wisconsin-Madison YAF. Kara's pretty humble, so I'm going to take a little moment to brag about her. Kara's chapter is best known for their speaking events, namely hosting Ben Shapiro this past November. The event saw an audience in excess of over 550 students, faculty, and community members. The chapter and its members faced threats of violent protests. They underwent investigations from the student government and university based on faulty hate and bias reports. And the school even told them to stop everything that they were doing until the school could figure out what was going on. A lot of people and a lot of organizations will stop right there. They'll wait for their school to act, and many of us know that the school likes to take a very long time and a drawn-out process. Fortunately, Kara and her chapter knew that this wasn't right. They refused to stop there. They continued to act. Went on to protest student government anti-campus carry campaigns and other liberal campaigns like hashtag UW Blackout and hashtag Not Our Campus. UW-Madison YAF investigated the Associate Students of Madison, ASM, Legislative Affairs Committee and liberal organizations that were communicating with legislators to denounce campus carry before it was reintroduced. They exposed these violations and brought media light to the faulty actions of the student government. The YAFers also conducted research into the 2017 Spring Course Catalog and brought light to a class titled The Problems with Whiteness. This garnered the attention of state legislators and later appeared on Fox News. University of Wisconsin-Madison YAF wrapped up their school year with a lecture in Steve Forbes, and the event amassed a crowd of attendees and media attention. And one thing I want to bring note to that's really important to recognize is that because of Kara and her chapter's perseverance and boldness, they caused Wisconsin to introduce a bill on their, state legislator, called the Wisconsin Free Speech Act. So I'd like to give her a round of applause for that. I'm going to introduce to the stage our conference director, Jolie Ballantyne.
Thank you, Kyle. Just really quickly, I'll leave Kyle. I won't take the mic away from Kyle too long. I just wanted to congratulate Kara personally one more time, but also announce that Kara, because of the work of Kara and her chapter, Young America's Foundation is proud to offer the University of Wisconsin-Madison Young Americans for Freedom chapter $10,000 to bring the speaker of their choice to their campus next year. Congratulations, Kara. And with that, I will turn the floor back over to Kyle Farabee.
So I hope everybody has a good night. I want to remind you guys that we have Freedom Karaoke tonight at 9 o'clock. I know at first sight, but whatever. When you first hear it, you think that might be a little awkward, getting on stage and singing before a bunch of people that you barely know, you've only gotten to know for the past 4 days. I'm telling you, it's a lot of fun. If we're really lucky, we might get to see His Majesty sing a song or two on stage. So 9 o'clock. Be here or be square. Everybody have a good night. Thank you.